Welcome to part 23 of the lecture on designing organic syntheses. Subject of today are radical, free radical cyclizations, where CC bonds are formed by a radical chain process. For instance, if you have a hexene moiety and you succeed in generating a radical center here, then it can cyclize, forming either this type of intermediary radical. And you know, this represents a 5-exotric cyclization according to Boltwin. Or a 6-endotric cyclization will occur. And you might be able to trap then this radical. One possibility to trap that is with tributyl tin and tributyl tin hydride. So in this case, it will lead to the hydrocarbons. So an expensive way to synthesize cyclohexane, of course. Nevertheless, it is a very interesting process. First of all, you have a very high selectivity for the 5-exotric process. The product ratio will be in the range of 50:1, although it is clear that thermodynamically this is the more stable intermediate. So this is kinetically favored. Moreover, this type of process is highly interesting since also very sterically hindered. CC bonds can be formed, well, for instance, with additional alkyl groups at these positions. Quaternary centers then can be formed. And it has a high functional group tolerance. So hydroxyl groups, NH groups, amino groups, cyano groups, all are tolerated. And that means we don't need protecting groups, the presence of alcohols, if we intend to perform these radical chain process for the construction of our ring system. Additionally, frequently a high diastereoselectivity is observed. Let's assume we have an additional substituent R here, another alkyl group, for instance. Again, trapping with a tin hydride. Preferentially, again, V5-exotric cyclization. The cis product will be preferentially formed, of course, diastereoselectively, not enantioselectively. You have a racemate here. Also, the cis product will be observed if you have the substituent here at the three position, counting from the radical center. With this result. In contrast, having the substituent R in the 2 position then you will have a trans product as a result and also with this intermediate, substituent R in 4 position, you will also get to a trans diastereoisomer. These are findings of Beckwith's group. Therefore, this is called Beckwith's rules. Let's have a look at an early example, well worked out by a pioneer of this radical chain processes, Gilbert Stork from the Columbia University, New York, with exercised at a terpenoid. Here we have a bicyclic system first, and well, it's a tricycle because here we have another 6-membered ring. There an olefin, there a methyl group, there also a methyl group, and here methyl group and hydrogen. So, constructing this type of skeleton, Stork decided to try a radical process. Well, but first of all, if we think about the retrosynthetic analysis, then it's clear again such an exocyclic double bond. First idea should be this is formed in the last step of our synthesis, just a Wittig reaction with a corresponding carbonyl compound. So, put on the carbonyl here. Yes, should be correct. So the last step as a Wittig type reaction all works with a 86% yield. Well, in the retrosynthetic analysis, they had obviously the idea to form this C-C bond by a radical process. Of course, this is indeed a strategic bond. If you break that, you have that bicyclic skeleton, you would hopefully build up by some kind of Diels-Alder process. Here an olefin, there a radical center. But we were also, of course, facing the problem that this CH3 group has to be somehow ando to this kind of cavity here. Okay, do you notice that? I hope so. How do you get the CH3 group into an ando position? Well, a simple idea is getting this done by a hydrogenation step having an olefin here, the hydrogen will approach from the axo phase, and that means the CH3 group will get to an ando position, of course. So, simply, hydrogenation with a palladium catalyst, and this works out just fine at about an 80% yield. So now one crucial step within the synthesis. So, homolytic ring cleavage for radical reaction within retrosynthetic analysis. Radical center here. Radical center there, but in reality, well, we could translate that into this situation having the double bond there. So, radical reacting with that double bond, forming radical center here. This should be trapped by a hydrogen radical. Okay? So now we have to translate that as synfins into synthetic equivalence. So, and the synthetic equivalence are having a vinyl bromide here and tributyl tin hydride as the synthetic equivalent for that radical hydrogen. So please keep in mind the stereochemistry at that olefin is not important at all, because this radical, well, the radical electron should be in a p orbital, okay? So if you form radical, well, it doesn't care, it of course can react with this position. So just that this becomes clear, we then have this situation. So and indeed the reaction conditions are having radical reaction chain starter AIBN, a well-known bis-isobutyronitrile, the tin hydride, and you can start that either by heating it up or photochemically. And this is a process that works very well. The transformation from here to that one succeeded in a 70% isolated yield. Sorry, we are missing CH3 groups here. Should now be correct. So let's go on with the retrosynthetic analysis. Of course, here, disconnecting there heterolytically, donator acceptor. So this is the nucleophilic starting compound after deprotonation. We don't have to care about the stereochemistry here. Deprotonating means we form the enolate, and then the electrophile should be attached from the sterically less hindered phase. And this is, of course, the one with that olefin, because here you have these sterically more hindering hydrogens. So nucleophilic component, and this the electrophilic component. So first lithiation, then trapping with this one. Okay, 80% yield was achieved. So rather good yields in all of those steps leading to the completion of the synthesis. So, how could we synthesize this one? Well, okay. Let's draw the starting compound. This is the starting compound for that synthesis. Forming the enolate at this position and trapping that with a cellulating agent gives with this cellul enol ether. This is obviously an electron rich diene. Now the reaction with the dienophile, maleinic anhydride, first maleinic anhydride in toluene, then secondly water and heating it up. So let's draw then the Diels Alder product. With the water, the anhydride will be hydrolyzed. Also, the TMS enolate will be hydrolyzed and will tautomerize to the ketone. So, and 77% yield was isolated of this one. The next step from here to there, so is an oxidative, a double oxidative decarboxylation, and at that time let tetraacetate in pyridine was applied, and unfortunately that gave a yield of about 30%, so that an overall yield from here to this was given 25%. So, if one has a better idea than this lead tetraacetate reagent improving that step, then it is a real nice synthesis. But nevertheless, this was one of the pioneering works for establishing a radical chain process for the construction of a framework of rather complex natural products. From the same group, also Gilbert Stork group, is prostaglandin synthesis, which is really very impressive. Typical for a lot of these syntheses, are cyclopentene moieties with oxygens already attached. Clear that these normally derive from ideals Alder reaction with singlet oxygen, was an endo peroxide, and then reducing it, and then with some methods, the enantiomers are separated, and here, from the corresponding alcohol, only one alcohol functionality is protected. The other is transferred to give an acetal like that, and photochemically a radical center is generated at this position. Photochemically, the carbon iodide bond is broken. So what will happen? Radical center here, CC bond formation, it is clear that a cis-anylated system will be formed. So we have a defined stereo selectivity at this position. Then a radical center is here, and the reaction was performed in the presence of an excess of this reagent, a reagent which can trap the radical. So, first step, intramolecular CC bond formation as a radical process. Then this radical reacts in an intermolecular trapping process, forming the CC bond from here to there. Having a radical center here, which is also stabilized by mesomerically with that carbonyl group, and this center then is also trapped with a radical hydrogen, making use of that tributyl tin hydride. By the way, for producing materials that or producing pharmaceuticals, you have to avoid strictly organotin compounds, because organotin compounds are rather toxic, and even, well, just amounts that you can just detect with AAS spectroscopy are already enough to prohibit selling those pharmaceuticals. Therefore, for an synthesis where you will indeed use these pharmaceuticals, you have to avoid tin, and there are some reagents with silicon hydrides which also works, but this is the initial approach and the most easy one. So, next step, you want to get rid of that TMS functionality. No problem. Just heating it up at 140 degrees. Rearrangement takes place. This has a name. The TMS enolate is formed. This is the so-called Brook rearrangement. And for the target molecule, we are already approaching, you need the transformation to an alpha beta unsaturated system. And this has been done with palladium acetate, not as a catalyst, but as a reagent. Okay, so an expensive test. However, prostaglandins in pure form are so expensive that one even could afford using palladium acetate stoichiometrically in such a synthesis. So, stoichiometrically, what happens? This is the nucleophilic center, this is the electrophilic center. A C-palladium bond will be formed there at this position, and then simply a beta hydride elimination, as we know from the usual palladium chemistry, also in catalytic processes, that will occur then. Ah, well, I'm pretty sure if you use palladium acetate in catalytic amounts and add some appropriate oxidizing agent, for instance, quinone or something like that, you can also get that done catalytically. Okay, and this oxidation is called the Segusa oxidation. So, let's draw that intermediate completely. So, the next steps, just three steps. First, with S being null H. So, what is that? I haven't seen that before either, but the name is clear. This derives from this binaphthyl moiety. I assume that is simply binol with an aluminum hydride. So oxygen, oxygen, aluminum hydride. Overall, because it's a trope chiral compound, this is then a chiral hydride donator. So this will react with the carbonyl group and will reduce that enantioselectively. So this transforms the alpha beta unsaturated ketone enantioselectively to this chiral allylic alcohol. So, in this case, diastereoselectively then. So, what else? Next step. HCl, water, THF. Well, these reaction conditions will hydrolyze that TMS, not TMS, silyl ether. On the other hand, it will also hydrolyze here the acetal. So that means we will have another OH group there. So what remains? After hydrolyzation of that acetal, we will have an aldehyde functionality here. And this aldehyde functionality is used for a Wittig reaction with this ullet. And since this type of ullet is known to give preferentially a cis olefin, then after hydrolysis we get to this result. So, and this is a prostaglandine with the abbreviation PLOS, PGF2-alpha. Okay. Over these three steps, 54% overall yield is obtained, and starting from here to get to that oxidized product, overall yield 58%. So that means almost 30% yield starting from that. Well, okay, you need a couple of steps to get to this intermediate in the complete synthesis. But I think rather impressive. So, next very famous synthesis. It's the hirsutin synthesis of Dennis Curran from 1986. The other stuff that we were talking about is chemistry of the 1770s of the last century. For the hirsutin synthesis, we only have a look at the key step. So it was performed as a racemic synthesis. So, and this is the substrate for the radical chain process. Again, the radical chain process starter, catalytic amounts. We need the tin hydride. Heat it up. And the first step, as usual, will be a 5-axotric reaction. Radical is formed here. I'm pretty sure that also with just photochemically, one should be able to start that reaction. So, CC bond formation from here to there. Stereochemistry at this position then is clear, because well, this chain is above the blackboard, so the radical will also approach from above. The radical center there. And now the next step, 5-exo dig cyclization at the diagonal center. Having the radical here, which is, of course, then trapped by the tin hydride. So, and the overall yield of this product, and this is already the natural product, although racemic, is 80%. Very nice reaction, I think. From the same group, the current group, a related reaction making use of the fact that with samarium diiodide, and a carbonyl group, for instance, an aldehyde, such a ketyl radical is formed, which can participate in a radical chain reaction, of course. So, Dennis Crowell made use of that in a synthesis of a related natural product related to hirsutin. And I think the other one who is renowned for his samarium chemistry, that is Gary Molander at Boulder, Colorado. And I think we discussed that type of chemistry in the lecture about stoichiometric organometallics. Well, so now here the aldehyde functionality. So, very similar setup. Difference is that acetal here and the aldehyde there. So, with samarium diiodide and afterwards hydrolysis, you need at least two equivalents of that. And after hydrolysis, this product was obtained by far more functionalized than hirsutin or the higher functionalization makes it more sensitive. Nevertheless, about 60% yield was isolated of that, also quite impressive, I think. For the next synthesis we have to discuss, we have to introduce another highly interesting reaction, radical reaction, the Barton reaction. You of course know Sir Derek Barton, who has won a Nobel Prize, not for this radical reaction, but for analysis of conformers. So, the Barton reaction, you start with an alcohol, treat that with nitrosyl cation, no, with a nitrosyl chloride in basic medium, pyridine, and as a result, you obtain a nitrous acid ester. Photochemically, the oxygen-nitrogen bond is cleaved. You get an oxyl radical and the nitrosyl radical. The oxyl radical will abstract a radical hydrogen at this position. You have this terminal, at the terminal position, that radical, and in the solvent cage, the nitrosyl, this will recombine to give this nitrosyl compound. This will rearrange the tautomerization to finally give the oxime, and you can make use of the oxime by some further transformations, for instance hydrolysis, giving a carbonyl compound, or reducing it to an amino group. So, in the next retrosynthetic analysis, it was one made use of this Barton reaction. Well, complicated name of a target compound, perhydrohistrionicotoxin. We don't need to keep that name in mind. Well, it's once again a synthesis from the Curry group. So the target molecule is this one. A spirocyclic compound . So, and retrosynthetic analysis, well, let's simplify this structure. So, this amine, we could envision that this derives from an imine like that. With some pentyl organometallic, a pentyl grignard, for instance. that would work. Yeah, well, in that case with Grignier, you should protect your age group, or on the other hand, pentyl Grignard is not that expensive. Just use two equivalents. The first one will get hydrolyzed by the OH group. The second one would react here. So, but this is of course interesting. You can envision that this imine functionality could derive from a lactame. And of course, you should know that lactames like that can be formed by a Beckmann rearrangement. You remember caprolactam? So, and therefore, retro Beckmann rearrangement within our retrosynthetic analysis. So that means from the six-membered ring derives from a five-membered carbocycle as an oxime. So, okay, and now imagine, where do we get this oxime from? Well, from a Barton reaction. From this. What about the selectivity? Why is this activated and not that? So let's have a look. Another drawing. Chair conformer. With this conformer, it would be clear that this CH2 group is in close proximity of this nitrosyl ester. Well, unfortunately, that conformer is not the preferred one, since these two groups are both in axial position. And that is the reason why this transformation unfortunately only worked with a 20% yield. Main product should be the radical reaction, radical oxidation at that side chain. Nevertheless, it is elegant, unfortunately, with not a very good yield, but well, okay, reasonable. So I think this is enough for today. Have a nice weekend. See you next Tuesday.